Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the thematic analysis for All of the Above, a transatlantic tune off of their first record, Simty. I've been leading this Neil Morse study group for a couple months now, and what we've been doing on a bi-weekly basis is going through his entire catalog chronologically and breaking down the pieces and seeing sort of his songwriting process, his compositional approaches, and really getting into Neil's head. So what I've done is taken this 31-minute prog epic and taken all of the major motivic content that makes up this tune and ties it all together, and I've analyzed it here to share with all of you. So in the documents below, there should be two links below in the description. One is the notation for all of those themes, handwritten in manuscript, and the other is a Word document that chronicles all of the appearances of these themes in chronological order as the tune progresses. What we will be doing in this video is not chronological. We will be going through each theme individually and as that particular theme develops throughout the piece. So there'll be a lot of jumping around. I'll try to yell out timestamps as much as possible, but it may get convoluted if I do it too much. So, without further ado, this is a lot of music to get through. Let's get to it. The very first fragment of music that happens in this piece is 30 seconds in, and it sounds like this. Pretty manic, pretty crazy, dissonant. It's this big chromatic descending riff in straight eighth notes. It's a pretty cool thing, and by itself, it doesn't seem like a whole lot. It has sort of a call and response with a rhythmic motif that we're going to get into. But what happens there is it's actually setting up what's to come later and is one of the most commonly recurring themes on the whole tune. So that was 1A. 1B is the same couple notes and the same contour of the line, but now instead of being chromatic or using all 12 notes, this is diatonic, fitting within one key, and they put a nice, lush, harmonic backdrop to it, and a slow groove, and they make it almost a gospel-y kind of feel, and that sounds like this, 1B. What's cool about this is this comes back multiple times in instrumental fashions, but not always. In one particular case, about 11:56 into the tune, it comes back. And Roiner does a great job of adding these phrasing differences and these different articulations, slides, different licks and embellishments that happen that keep that earworm fresh in your head. But at 11:56, when that theme is iterated, it ends and segues into a vocal section. And as it continues, you'll hear this guitar melody playing in the right ear while Neil sings over the harmonic content. Now it's being played in a synth. Sign of it is right here. And that harmonic component of that motif is now laying the foundation for that vocal section. Pretty cool. And it helps develop that and also sort of reaping the seeds that you'd sown in the overture section for the first 5 minutes. Another key ingredient of a great prog epic, don't have any vocals come in before the 5 minute mark. We'll give it about a 10 second leeway since this one is 4:54. Then again, one more time, at the very end of the tune, 1B comes back. Now it's in the key of G instead of A flat. Thank you. So now that you've heard those within the context of the transatlantic recording, I thought it would be best to pre-record a bunch of guitar and bass parts so you could hear that in isolation. So we're going to go back to 1A, and what you're going to hear are bass and guitar playing that chromatic riff in unison. So that's 1A, big chromatic part. Now when you want to hear 1B, you hear the similarity, but it's not even close to the same. It's a nice dichotomy, but also still digging out those earworms that we've planted in there subconsciously. A great component in Chief songwriting. And a nice non-diatonic twist at the end with that chord. More on that in another video. Let's go on to the second motif, which is not a melodic motif, but it's actually a rhythmic one. So while there aren't direct notes to be attached to this, it recurs so often that you couldn't not have it. So the first time you hear that is actually within the first couple seconds of the tune. And it's played on a clean guitar right after this big chromatic riff. And that's in 2A. That sounds like this by itself. By itself, doesn't sound like a whole lot. But with that being teased right off the bat, and then they go back into that 1A chromatic riff, when it comes back, it lays the foundation for this developmental section that comes immediately after that. No matter the modulation, no matter what the riff is, the rhythmic content remains the same. And is the single unifying factor of that entire riff. Now, 2A and 2C are very closely related, and the solo section that comes immediately after that, the guitar riff, is laying the foundation for the chord solo that needs to go to the top. You hear 1A one more time. The synth motif from Half Alive. We'll get into that. So you hear this rhythm quite a few times in the overture alone. The next time we hear it is around 318. And now this sets back up into this big groove. We're listening to 2B. That acoustic rhythm is 2B, and it lays the foundation for this entire section with that flute synth going on, which is now doubled by a synth. But that acoustic rhythmic part very reminiscent of Crack the Big Sky off of Day for Night, another Neil Morse epic. But that lays the foundation for a synth melody we're going to get into later, 4A. So, with that being said, we move on to the development that happens around the 8-minute mark, a little before that, at 7:57. Right after Full Moon Rising, second A. We have the same rhythm, but now there's a moving layer. And summarized on a guitar, that would sound like this. And move moving those triads up. B flat and a C. He's playing a big C chord there, and later you'll hear it as a B flat Lydian chord. So all he's doing differently in this version, he's playing a C in the bass. When you hear it later, there's a B flat. Same notes being played on top. But now that the bass note's different, you hear it in a different context. For example, we have... It has a Mixolydian vibe to it. Which leads into another motif. So, moving on with this motif, you hear it one last time, 24-26 in the tune. Which comes after the undying love section. This will lead back into a full moon rising. And then into the 5-1. So, that is motif 2B. It's very malleable. You hear it in acoustic guitars, you hear it in piano, you'll hear it in bass, you'll even hear it in the drums sometimes. But it's constantly gluing certain sections together and serving as transitional foundations, especially in the full moon rising sections. It's really great for also throwing in new harmonies. And in Mike Portnoy's words, when asked by Steve Morse, can we change keys this often? And he goes, oh yeah, Neil and I do it all the time. We just throw it in there whenever we feel like it. This is one of the ways they get away with it, by having a continuity with a rhythmic motif such as this. Now we go into motif number 3, which is melodic and harmonic. This one is featured very heavily in the Half Alive section. Now, in context, it sounds like this. Out of context, played by a guitar and a bass laying foundation, some chords. Notice in the middle of beat 3, there's one note that changes, and that is so that it follows the E flat and the C chords properly. So it switches modes just a little bit, but it makes it really interesting. So that synth line is planted and then immediately taken away. But what you have left, in context, are the chords. And this becomes a harmonic motif as well as melodic. They rip the melody out. Just the chords being played in the guitar and a bass groove, which is super cool. And it does come back later, which is always great. So, that melodic motif comes back, sort of, at 2:14. This is, for the people following along, this is 3C. They take the outline of that motif that we heard here, this one. Take that outline and they make it a little bit simpler, and then as a jumping off point for this extrapolation and this expositional movement. Ba-da-da-da-da. It's like ba-da-da-da-da-ba. You have the same contour, the same strong beat notes, the same accented notes in the phrase, but now you have an end phrase that's very different every time it gets played. Same chordal groove underneath. Great call and response going on between the synth. That little fragment, that two-beat fragment, sets up this several-minute section. Pretty cool. So, later, we hear this melody come back. Oh, man. This comes back quite a bit later. This comes in at around 1827. This is in the Half Alive section. So we'll hear it as this. You hear this in a new key, but you're hearing those hits just as you did before in 7/8. Isolated, it would sound like this. Very basic. Functional. But you hear it now, instead of being in G, it's in D. The first note starts on the fifth and works from there. It's sort of the connective tissue of this Half Alive section. So you'll hear Neil sing right after that. That's sort of an A B section going with the vocal. After that second one, though, instead of playing it the way he's been playing it in the overture and throughout this section, now that we've heard this our fourth time, instead of making that lead up a chromatic from the F sharp up to the A, he turns it into a pentatonic lick instead of a chromatic lick. So much like he did with 1A, a chromatic into a diatonic lick or into a standard key, he does that and simplifies it even further and makes it a pentatonic lick, which sounds like this. Notice how that goes quite a bit lower than. A little bit of a trigger, just a little bit, and it adds so much to that section and keeping things fresh, keeping things moving forward, progressing, progressive rock. By definition, Neil achieves this in spectacular fashion, which is super cool. At 21:42, this expositional jumping off point comes back, 3C, which we haven't heard beginning of the tune in the overture. It's in a new key again. When we first heard this at 2:14, it sounded like this. Full groove. Still has that contour, that outline of that phrase, but now it's under a different groove. Very open, spacious. Foundation of the entire section. Hearing the call with your back to the wall in a wordless conundrum. Half of your life between a rose and a knife in a time. You're sure to find illusion. have that a little bit in there. You'll hear it. Part of it's rhythmic, part of it's motivic and melodic, but you do hear it. And that is the synopsis for Motif 3, which is melodic and harmonic. You do hear it quite a bit through the tune, but now we work into Motif 4. If you're still with me after 20 minutes, props. Or if you jumped to this point, good job, you cheater. So, now we move on to 4A, my personal favorite melody of the entire tune. I have this stuck in my head on a daily basis. So, this is the melody. Then the full groove. So what's happening there is it's just this big scalar lick with a certain contour. And when it's first presented with the synth, it's all the notes that are in black on your notation. But a very interesting thing happens when the guitar comes in. The guitar player changes one note. Only one note. It's on the E of 2 in the phrase. He goes down instead of going up, and it creates this very quick, subtle harmony, but the difference is there. And Neil continues to play what he's been playing. So that's set up in E flat under that nice rhythmic motif that we heard earlier. So we'll hear it. Going to a little suspension, coming back. At the turnaround, you're going to E flat minor 7 chord or a 2 chord. Sitting at E flat 5. Big dominant 7 flat 9 sound that happens. Pretty cool at the end. We'll get into the turnaround in a moment. It's another motif within a motif. Kind of cool. Motivic inception. So when you hear that again, it's sort of rehashed in this way at 4C, where it's a turnaround within the Full Moon Rising section. That's the melodic hook of the section. Vocal A and a vocal B. After the full moon rising today. Every time it comes back, there's something different. Slightly. Usually Mike, his drum part, his accents, his phrasing. But not each time. When it comes back at 8:58 in the tune, they add an octave in the guitar. That rhythmic motif, 2A. High guitar. Pretty cool. Now, this motif only happens in the first quarter of the tune, maybe the first third. And it's kind of cool that this motif is used so heavily in the front, and it's still an earworm at the end. It's very sing-songy, in a way. Something to note about 4A and 4C, the difference, when you look at beat 3 and 4, the intervallic content changes. Instead of jumping a third on the end of that third beat, you only jump a second. And based on the chord that you're sitting on, it almost makes more sense this way. So we're going to show you what 4C sounds like out of context, isolated. And then 4A. Notice that last note jumps a little bit higher than it does here. But what's kind of cool about that is that it adds that subtlety of progression throughout. Again, this is a common theme you're going to hear all the time through this video and all through this catalog and in the entire genre of great progressive rock music. Progression, deviation, and a nice extrapolation of this idea that just keeps permutating throughout. And it's an old prog ingredient of, oh, I had this idea, but I also had this idea. Which should I choose? The answer is both or all of them. Choose all the ideas and use them differently in subtle different ways throughout the piece. And the listener will keep going, I haven't heard that either. It's kind of cool. Even he's getting impatient with this. So let's move on to the turnaround. So apparently this video is too prog for its own good and filled up the SD card. So now we're back and the lighting has changed because the sun has gone down. It's a long video. We're going to get into turnaround one, as I've labeled it T1 in your notation. Now, the first time we hear this, it's a part of that first motif in the synth section for 4A. That's it, it's just two beats. But now they add a tail to it, extend it, and repeat it. So that is just extending a phrase. So it works as the turnaround and then as an extension. Now we're going to hear it as thematic glue between that synth section and another theme entirely. New crunchy chord builds attention. G7 flat 9. Big A flat 9 that we talked about earlier. So that's the first time that we really hear it, and it's attached to the 4A yet again. So in between the verse chorus sections of Full Moon Rising, we have 4C being rising played just normally. But after the second chorus, when it comes back again, it leads into an entirely different movement. So, this transition or turnaround has functioned as a turnaround within a phrase, between a couple phrases as an extension, transitioning between phrases or motivic ideas, and now between movements of a piece. That's pretty significant. It goes from the micro to the macro, and it's still only two beats of music, just stretching it out, putting it under different chords. Pretty cool. But it doesn't stop there, because every one of those has been attached to the fourth motif, the synth line. Now it's going to be attached to the fifth motif, which we'll get into in a little bit. But around 909 in the tune, they go into that and they tease you with this harmonic motif. And then they throw this turnaround on there, which was never attached to it in the first place. Sneaks it in. Piano plays it, and it was a giant solo. hear it again at the end of the solo. It's at 11:22. Guitar. And even bass. Everyone plays this mode, including Mike Porter, who plays it on drums a couple times. But it's a pretty cool thing. It serves so many purposes, almost every purpose you could have for connective tissue. And it's just two beats of music. Well worth study, well worth talking about. Now, what we're about to get into is the fifth motive, and quintessential for Neil Moore's songwriting. So if you've ever heard Neil Moore's prog, this is probably in there. And if you've heard a collaborative effort of his, you can be sure that he wrote this section. This is a harmonic motif, number 5. Now, what Neil likes to do is he'll play different chords in his right hand. Excuse me while I plug this in. He likes to play different chords in his right hand while he pedals a bass note. You'll hear it throughout Spock's Beard. Every record has it that he's on. You'll hear it on every solo album he has that's a prog writing thing, every collaboration. So, for example, the Full Moon Rising chords are F, B flat over F, C over F, and back. In a state of falling grace, with a smile upon its face, it came. Finally switches. And that's in the A section, the verse, if you want to call it that. The B section does it just a little bit on the bookends. So you'll have a D in the bass. This has never been before. Still in the bass, and it'll switch. The summer's brightest day. Rest of the section, he'll be holding those chords. The full moon rise today. The full moon rising today. And then back to that F. But it really hunkers down what you're doing in terms of key center. It keeps you grounded in F. Even though all these other chords are playing, you know that's the mode that's happening. So this happens all throughout Full Moon Rising. This is the section. So naturally, anytime the Full Moon Rising motif comes back, that's what's happening harmonically. You get a little tease of it at 909, like we mentioned, in that solo setup. This is after October Sky. And it's just in there a little bit, and it comes in after that big motif. At this point, it's just revisiting the themes that they've already played and cashing in on them. And then into that solo. This comes back at the very end of the tune. You'll hear it, and instead of being in F, it'll be in G. In a state of falling grace, with a smile. And out of context, in an isolated format, you would hear this. Notice how that bass part is still hunkered down that G, and then. Also creates an extension of the chord. So you get F Now it's an E instead of D from before. So this whole Full Moon Rising chunk just went up a whole step from its original iterations. And then, favorite part. Nia loves Gentle Giant. There's a little bit of Gentle Giant for you. But anyways, that is the harmonic feature that we have. Pedaling a bass note and moving the chords around it. It's usually 1, 4, and 5, or maybe a flat 7. Usually the same quality of the chord that you're playing. Not always, but oftentimes in Neil's writing. So that is motif 5, the harmonic motif. Write that one down if you want to write like Neil. This last motif is pretty cool because it is self-contained. It only happens in this section, which makes me wonder if Neil wrote it or if this was a P. Trouble-Voss sort of thing. Now, it only happens in Camouflaged in Blue, and Neil wrote the lyrics for this, but musically, it's just a bass line. It's just one bar of music, going from a 2-chord to a 5-chord. And in its setup, it's a D minor. Or starts on a D minor chord, rather. Dorian. And it'll go up to E minor. This is what the vocals will be based on. The vocal verses are all over that E minor to E minor to A7. And then it goes up a whole step, but only as a turnaround in the section to create this harmonic dissonance, this almost a dominant feel. So for a couple iterations coming up here, it'll jump up a whole step. Almost like an A-A-B-K sort of thing. And back down. Pretty cool. But it's such a simple thing that can permutate throughout this whole section. And then the chorus is different. Then they do that whole cycle again. And what I like about this is it also serves as the foundation of another solo section. And as it progresses, Mike Portnoy on drums is changing what he's doing so often and developing it to potentially metrically modulate the 6-8 and then take the same riff that's in 4 and put it in 6-8, which happens around 1742. And then they abandon that lick altogether, but keep the harmonic structure. And then Roy Nastolt takes a big, lengthy solo. So, that is the thematic analysis for all of the above. One other thing that I didn't notate, but I think it's worth mentioning. Most of the melodies within this tune are upbeat dependent. And what that means is that instead of singing a melody where most of the phrases land on the beat, most of them land on upbeats. Full moon rising. Full moon rising today. Even when it's reiterated later, and this full moon rising up the way. Almost every word is on an upbeat. Camouflaged in blue. Camouflaged in blue. camouflaged in blue. They're all upbeats and also undying love. And to hear that in context with just the last one. Innocence and undying love will reign.
Innocence and undying love will reign.
Kind of cool, and may not have been intentional, could be coincidental, but I don't think so. I think it definitely unifies the melodies that are so distinct and different throughout this very long piece of music, very dense, and it creates this subconscious earworm, things that they are constantly cashing in on. That's it for the thematic analysis. I hope you enjoyed this. If you wish to join the group, there's a link below. Just ask to join. Answer a couple questions. What your favorite Neil Morse album is and what you like to hear. What you like to study about Neil. What you'd like to see more of in that group should you join. And you are welcome to all of the documents. There are some transcriptions. There are analyses of every album that we've done thus far. And there will continue to be that as things go. We may even dive into his gospel stuff, his worship music. We'll dive into his singer-songwriter stuff, as we've done with his solo albums. And it's a great time. It's a great place for us to meet and just talk about the music and the music alone. We don't have to get into all the other stuff that the forum gets into. So come check it out. It's a good time. And enjoy this. Now go back and listen to this 31-minute prog epic masterpiece. I'll put a link to that below as well. And listen with fresh ears. An informed set of ears. Thanks. And I will see you later.